rose-colored glasses are off. It's time to get real. Yet, we remain hopeful still. This is the Marketing Disenchanted Podcast. I am your host, Temitayo Osinubi. Let's get to it. Welcome to episode 31 of the Marketing Disenchanted Podcast. This week, I had the delight of chatting with none other than the burger hero, the connoisseur of patty meats himself, Rev Ciancio. David Rev Ciancio is a senior marketing, branding, and digital strategist with 20 years of experience in digital marketing and business development, specializing in hospitality marketing, content, and local SEO. He has led many clients to new levels of local, national, and international success in the hospitality, financial service, and entertainment sectors, and recently joined Yext as their director of partner marketing. Rev is an expert burger taster and pens BurgerConquest.com, one of the world's top three burger blogs, where he provides marketing insight and tips. And so without further ado, let's hop into our interview with Rev Ciancio. Rev, thanks so much for joining me.
Thank you for having me. It's an honor.
You are the director of partner marketing at Yext, and you were just a track leader at Social Media Marketing World, which is kind of a big deal, but nobody starts out at the top. Everybody starts somewhere. So tell us that story. Take us on that journey. When did you first get bit by the bug, and how did you become enchanted with digital marketing?
Oh, man, that is a question that goes back very, very, very far. When I left college, I very much wanted to be in the radio broadcasting business. I mean, at the time, you know, 1996, to date myself, you know, in terms of media, TV and radio were really sort of the top of the pile. And I had a penchant for marketing, but I also really liked music. So that's why I went that route. But I moved out to New York City to do radio promotions. And no joke, Timmy, my first job, I didn't even have a computer. I had a terminal. So, you know, we plugged in green screen, dot matrix, like, and I was doing radio promotions, and it was somewhere in there. You know, I'd had a pilot account from my college days where I could email people that were also had pilot accounts. And I looked at the owner of the agency I was working for, and I said, you know, we're doing marketing to all these radio stations across, you know, the United States. Why don't we send them an email blast? So if, you know, we can't get them on the phone, they like still get our information. And he was like, I don't know what email is. Send out a fax. And a little known fact about me is I actually sent the very first email blast in the history of the music business.
That's what's up.
Yeah, we had an AOL account that was, you know, assigned to the company. And the owner of the company at the time told me he didn't want me wasting work hours to do, you know, whatever this email thing was. So I had to come in at like 6 a.m. on a Thursday morning, you know, do the AOL dial-up thing. And I composed an email blast like, hey, here's the records we're working this week. You know, here's some information on the bands on tour. And that was probably my first step into digital. And then when I realized, like, what an amazing time saver that was, you know, instead of having to, you know, we called it smiling and dialing. Instead of having to call 136 radio stations, you know, the course of a work week, like I could just send out an email. And, you know, when we got on the phone, I didn't have to go through all the nitty gritty because they had it in their inbox, you know.
Cool. So when was the honeymoon over? When did you become disenchanted? Not necessarily disillusioned, but it's kind of like marriage, right? When you first get started, everything's new and different. Then you find out that this person snores like a dying moose and has all these other quirks. So when did things get real for you with digital marketing and you got down to brass tacks?
I mean, there's probably a couple touch points, but I think MySpace was the first time that I was like, okay, we took this too far. You know, again, I come from a music business background originally, and, you know, the music business was really sort of other outside of tech, the first industry to adopt, you know, social media in particular. You know, and I remember calling my bands while they were, you know, touring. I'd be like, hey, did you update your MySpace page? And they'd be like, why? It's not important. I was like, oh my God, you don't understand. And then all of a sudden, like, that wave hit, and, you know, MySpace was basically overtaken by like local bands and small bands. And then it became everything was spammy and put me in your top eight and you're getting everything in your inbox. And I really think that plus the ability to download music really sort of changed, at least from the music business aspect, how digital media and digital marketing works. So blame Metallica. That's really what I'm saying.
Blame Metallica. Absolutely. So if you had a time machine, and you could go back and talk to your younger self, you know, without causing any paradoxes or cataclysms to the space-time continuum.
That's important.
Yes, I watched Doctor Who. Very important. what are the top three things you would tell your younger self to help prepare for your career?
Oh man, I don't know that I have anything specific because I kind of like I like life to be a little serendipitous. But specifically, I remember wanting to do a radio show in high school, and you know we had one of these like 16-watt stations that like broadcasted from the gymnasium to the edge of the parking lot, and I really thought that was cool, and I really wanted to do it. But the only other guy that was on air staff in my high school was this guy named Gary, and he wore a different Iron Maiden shirt to school every day, and I thought he was cool, but the rest of the school thought he was a toolbox, and I didn't want to be a toolbox. So I didn't want to be associated with Gary, so I didn't go do a radio show. And thinking back now, you know, several decades later, I wish I would have not been so short-sighted. I wish that I would have gotten into radio broadcasting then, and I wish that I would have started, let that be the beginning of my personal brand journey.
There you go. It's a lot of good transferable skills. Like if you'd have told me just a year ago, I'd have been doing a podcast right now. I'd have laughed at you. So, you know, hindsight's always 2020. So now I'm going to ask you.
You know, the other thing, one more thing, I would have told myself not to sell my Apple stock both times.
Oh, God, no. You had Apple stock, dude.
Twice.
Oh, yeah. That one hurt a little bit. That's like, you know, getting in Google ground floor and selling too soon.
Yeah, but like at the time, I was like, oh, my God, I made so much money. But if I still had it now, it wouldn't matter. Like, it'd be great.
Oh, wow. Yeah, yeah. You wouldn't be talking to me right now. So, I mean, it all works out in the end, I suppose.
But that's definitely like, you know, Marty, you know, letting Biff take the sports almanac.
That one stung just a little bit. So now I'm going to ask you to look into the future. So one of the areas of digital that I focus on is mobile / connected devices / Internet of Things. And sort of the standard example that everybody gives is the smart refrigerator that knows when you're out of milk and automatically adds it to your shopping list, which is then delivered to you via Amazon Drone. In that example, that's what they call a closed loop system because you don't actually have to leave the house. It's like the Jetsons, everything's automatic. And so there have been murmurs that, you know, what's marketing going to look like in that environment? Are marketers still going to have a job because everything is so animated? And I know that, you know, your crystal ball works about as good as mine does, which is to say not very well at all. But given that, you know, future closed loop system, which is just around the corner, how do you see marketing evolving and do you think we'll still have jobs?
Well, yeah, that's a great question. I think there's going to be room for a lot of people to have jobs because, you know, even though I think AI is, I mean, it's here, but it's going to develop, you know, pretty quickly, you know, and they're predicting that the singularity will happen in 2029, which is really not that far away. Like, there's still going to need to be somebody who can conceptualize what these robots and what this artificial intelligence needs to do. And, you know, there'll never be a point at which AI can have the sort of the gut or creativity that a human can. It can replicate it, right? But it will never hit a point where, you know, sort of that what makes us human will happen. So there's going to be room for people that need to creatively think of how to use AI. And then there, of course, will be people, there'll be tons of room for people who know how to harness AI. So I think people who are heavy into like data and data sciences are going to have a future in a future job in that.
2029, that's crazy. My last time I checked, they were saying 2045. Now 2029, that's wild. Man, I gotta get my stuff together. So
I mean, that was one of the takeaways from attending Social Media Marketing World this week or last week. Was people talking about when will the singularity happen? What is the future of AI? Look, and you know, I think from an AI perspective and where we're headed, right? So let's say you want to search something. You're looking for where to have lunch, or you know, you need to buy a hammer, or you need a last minute plumber, right? Your brain, right? If I say that to you, you visualize going to a browser, typing in a Google search, and getting back some results, right? Now, 2 or 3 years ago, that was a bunch of blue links, right? But that's changed. Right now we get the knowledge card, or we get like the, you know, the 3-pack, and you get an image and you get a map and you get some data and you get some office hours, right? Or you get things like that are relevant to the business. And that's manageable knowledge, right? That is the data knowledge of those brands. And for me, the immediate future is the mapping of that information to the publisher networks, right? So if you're a business, you're a pizza shop, and you don't have control of your brand knowledge online, you're missing out. Right, because I think a brand is ultimately way more searchable through the publisher networks than they are their own website. Right, so what does that mean?
I come see you in Atlanta next week, and you're like, I was like, yo, man, you got to take me for some great pizza. You look over at your Siri or your Google Home or Alexa and go, hey, I want to take Rev for pizza tomorrow night. They got to be open at 7:30. I know this guy likes bacon on his pizza. They got to have a parking spot, and it's got to be 4 stars or higher. Well, what's going to happen, right? You're going to get a voice answer, and Alexa's going to say, oh, you need to go to NYC Pizza, blah, blah, blah. I have a spot for you. The waiter will be waiting for you, right? You're not going to see any blue links. You're not going to see any knowledge card. You're not going to see any maps. You're just going to get an answer, right? So if you're, as a business, if your data is not correct or structured in a way that, you know, the publisher networks want to see it, you're in a bad place. Like, you're in a really bad place.
Yeah, deep waters, my friends, deep, deep waters. So you, Gary V, and Brian Solis are chilling at the conference, having a straight talk, no BS mini mastermind, or insert whichever thought leader if you happen to be at a different conference, Andrew Davis, whoever. What would you say is severely lacking from the professional digital marketing landscape, and how would you brainstorm about correcting it?
Oh, man, no pressure on that one. I think that structured data and brand knowledge, it is integral to the way that the internet works today and going to become more integral moving forward. And I don't think that businesses understand yet that it's a problem, right? If you open up a hardware store or you have products that you sell, thinking about how the search engines and the other publisher networks find that data and are relevant to search, I think is the most important part of marketing today. It's currently like an SEO conversation, but it's really a brand conversation, right? So for me, if I'm talking to these thought leaders, you know, I'm saying, okay, how do we educate people to understand that this is how the web works? And if you don't use it in that manner, you're going to fail your own business, right? So I want to help people, and that would be the conversation I'd want to have.
Gotcha. Very astute. So we are going to take a short break, and then when we get back, we're going to dive deeper with Mr. Rev Ciancio. So stick with me. We've all heard the stories. New mom starts a blog while on maternity leave, and now she's a multimillionaire. Or the pizza boy with just a GED who now makes more than all of his teachers combined. Or that one guy that got stricken with some calamity that left them bedridden for 6 months or something like that. You get my point. Insert cliche here. They would all have you believe it's as simple as getting online, finding success, and living happily ever after. Rinse and repeat. And eternal optimist that you are, you think, why not me? And you fall for it. Hook, line, and sinker. You quickly find yourself completely overwhelmed with digital business operations, disappointed, and ultimately disenchanted with the whole online success fairy tale. Well, friends, you're not alone. Now, I can hear the groans of objection now. You're just being negative. Those stories are real. That really happens to people. And yeah, that has been known to happen. And people have also been known to win the lottery or marry their high school sweetheart after falling in love at first sight. But then you have the rest of us. Those stories often leave out the lucky breaks, support systems, and hard skills needed to truly achieve success online. I don't. Through the Marketing Disenchanted podcast, I've connected you with top thought leaders and real online professionals, not outliers who don't recognize themselves as such. Through these candid, no BS conversations, we discuss what it's really like to achieve success online and give you the tools and strategies to do the same. Did you know I'm also available to you for speaking engagements, digital discernment workshops, and even one-on-one Skype or telephone consults? Go to consulttemi.com and book me for your next event. That's consulttemi.com and click on the speaking tab. You see, being a real digital marketing professional doesn't have to be a pipe dream left unfulfilled, but you gotta take the rose-colored glasses off and get real. So go to consulttemi.com to book me, and I look forward to seeing you in person. And remember, tactics change, but principles don't. So don't get bewitched by the shiny ball syndrome. See you soon. And we're back. So, Rev, Myself and my co-author, we wrote a book last year called Beyond Buzzwords, and the buzzword of 2016 was hands down influencer marketing. You heard all about influencer marketing. Jay Baer over at Convince and Convert, he launched a podcast called Influence Pros, and those in the space warned that it was only a matter of time before we had a spectacular train wreck. Not just a regular train wreck, but a spectacular train wreck. I'm talking mushroom cloud, debris everywhere, and we got that courtesy of one PewDiePie. So for those who don't know, PewDiePie is like the original rags to riches YouTube success story. He went from just a guy to having a YouTube channel, and he makes approximately $4 million a year. He previously had relationships with Disney and Maker and a few other big names. And the reason I said previously is because PewDiePie fashions himself as an amateur humorist, and he decided to take shots at the website Fiverr and all the crazy things you can get people to do for as little as $5. However, the way in which he chose to go about this was that he hired people to do anti-Semitic things, which I will not repeat on the show. And so this has sparked a very interesting case study slash debate in the influencer marketing space. So my question is actually twofold. How do you see this PewDiePie fiasco affecting influencer marketing? Because, you know, Disney actually received a little bit of blowback for abandoning PewDiePie, which they should have. Chris Brogan actually made a very good point on the Marketing Companion podcast by Tom Webster and Mark Schaefer, saying that, you know, digital native slash millennial, they use language differently, and what offends us doesn't offend them. And that's a whole nother rabbit hole. And the second part to the question is that, you know, in this whole clickbaity internet that we find ourselves in, you know, the trend has been toward ever more salacious headlines, ever more outrageous things. So do you think this PewDiePie thing will serve to embolden other would-be YouTube stars, or do you think it'll have a cooling effect?
That is a very, very astute question after thinking through where we were going to go with this conversation. I did hear that podcast with Mark and Tom and Chris, and I do agree that, you know, hopefully what I think this signals, right, is there's a difference in the way that, you know, millennials and younger talk, and the things that are interesting to them are different than people who are, you know, on the tail end of the millennial spectrum or beyond it, like I am, right? And so this will hopefully help those who don't understand the way the younger generation talks and thinks give better insight into them and help them be better marketers. But to really answer your question, I think it's going to have a cooling effect, but I would call it more of a self-correcting effect, right? So my guess is that Disney in the situation didn't take a deep dive into PewDiePie. I don't think they did their due diligence to go through who he is and what he does. They just saw numbers, right? And sort of the way everything works, you know, when there's a new trend or a new platform or a new something, you know, people want to be the first to dive in. People want to be early adopters. And Disney probably said, look, you know, we don't know how to speak to millennials, right? We know how to speak to 3-year-olds and, you know, 43-year-olds. So maybe this will help get us there. And, you know, I'm sure that he did connect them to that audience on some level. But was it the right audience? That's really the question. And I think what this PewDiePie thing is going to do is help people who oversee and control influencer marketing dollars take a deeper look into what they're trying to do. And, you know, from doing my own levels of influencer marketing, right? So getting somebody to talk about your product only has so much value, right? Like what is the value of a like, right? And you could say, oh, well, it's branding. Okay. I'm a call to action guy, right? So how did it affect the bottom line? How did it affect the brand awareness? What did you get out of that? And so I think what what happened with PewDiePie is going to make influencer marketing people look at, what am I actually trying to do here? What is the effect I want to have? And hopefully that the value, a vanity value like, will have to take a back seat to, you know, more direct calls to action. And I think that's what is going to be the effect of that conversation.
Agreed. Vanity likes, they look good, they feel good, but it's not ultimately what drives the bottom line. I mean, you're absolutely correct. You got to do your research on these people.
When I was running my agency, right, prior to working at Yext, my number one source of lead gen, you know, for marketing services was Instagram. And people are like, that's crazy. Like, where do you click out of, you know, there's only one link and it's in your bio. And I would say, well, you know, I built an audience that was interested in a particular subject, right? And then clicking the link in the bio was self-selecting, right? If you were going to take the time to go over to my bio and click that link and go to whatever piece of content I was throwing at you, right, you're already of the mindset of the person I want to talk to. And if you read that piece of content and it looked interesting to you and you clicked contact me at the bottom, right, again, self-selecting, right? And so, you know, it's about understanding how to use these tools and who are the people that you want to connect with and what is the call to action.
Absolutely. So large corporations are just now starting to get on board with digital marketing. Going back to the whole influencer marketing question, but not with as much gusto as they do traditional marketing. But that's certainly the trend because, you know, you have digital marketing departments in larger corporations where before you didn't have any positions at all. However, when you look at the ad spend, it's disproportionately going to Facebook and Google. Like, it's not even close. And the laws of supply and demand dictate that, you know, when you have a limited number of ad inventory and all of these dollars flowing into it, that the cost is going to go up. And we have seen that the cost per click in different verticals has steadily been rising. So do you think that's going to lead to a situation where you have the haves and have nots in terms of digital marketing, where, you know, the clicks are just so expensive that only the big boys can play there and the smaller players get pushed out? Or do you think that, you know, true to its nature, the internet will remain disruptive, and when Facebook and Google get too big for their britches, you know, people will spin off to something else? And
I would say the latter, you know, and sort of the way, you know, I think that marketing works in this day and age is, right, somebody opens up a hole that gets filled by a bunch of people, right? And by being first on the pike or an early adopter, like, oh, everybody wants a piece of that. Like, let's use HubSpot, right? So HubSpot is great for inbound marketing, right? It's a one-size-fits-all solution for inbound marketing. Well, what is that? That leaves the ability for somebody to come and go, oh, we're going to make an inbound marketing tool for restaurants only. And they're going to think about the special needs of that vertical. And they become a disruptor to HubSpot, right? So the same thing with Facebook. Like, look, I think Facebook ads are the future of advertising. And if I was overseeing a budget, I'd be like, how can we maximize this, right? But eventually, like, the audience that you're looking for in any genre is going to have its own channel. It's going to have its own location. It's going to have its, you know, its own center point for an audience. And so I think it's just going to push people with, you know, advertising budgets to find where are those places where those people are gathering information. You know, I know, like, reaching me on Facebook and reaching my mom on Facebook is not the same thing, right? And I'm probably spending five times the amount of my time on Instagram than I am Facebook. Now, granted, they're owned by the same company. I know that's not the greatest example, but from a marketing aspect, if you want to reach me, you have to go where my eyeballs are. You know what I mean?
Absolutely. So last question, I'll let you get back to your day, and I do appreciate you taking the time. It's a modified version of the last question that John Lee Dumas asked on his Entrepreneur on Fire podcast, but I'm steering it in a very particular direction, and I want you to understand why I'm asking it the way that I'm asking it. So there's a gap in the digital marketing education space in terms of career trajectory. And by professional, I mean somebody who works in-house at a brand or on the agency side. I'm not referring to digital entrepreneurship, somebody like a Pat Flynn or a John Lee Dumas, even though you could absolutely make the case that they're pros because they operate at such a high level. Not who I'm talking about. I'm talking about people with jobs, right? People who get a W-2 at the end of the year. So in terms of professionalizing yourself, there's sort of three standard paths. The first is that you meander the wilds of Google for a year or 10 or however long. And there is some really good information out there, a lot of it for free. But contrary to popular belief, rooting it out does take a little bit of skill. You might land on Convince and Convert. You might end up doing Amway. Like who knows where that rabbit hole goes? You can do what I did, which was go back to school and get a degree in internet marketing. The cons there is that it's very expensive. I had to borrow the better part of $60,000 to get my undergraduate. And it's time consuming, because even though my degree program was accelerated, it still took 30 months to complete, which in the digital marketing landscape is several lifetimes. But by far the most prevalent way that people educate themselves and disseminate best-in-class practices is through conferences and seminars, like Social Media Marketing World, for example. The cons there is that even though in aggregate it's a lot less expensive than getting a degree, you have to have that money up front. So some of your better conferences, you're looking at $500 to $1,500 just to get through the door. That doesn't include your flight, your hotel, Uber, eating out for however many days. After you add all that back in, you're looking at $3,000 to $5,000 out of pocket. And some of the conferences, like a ClickFunnels, they're going to have a VIP coaching program or Inner Circle or something to that effect, and they can be upwards of $10,000. So I'm trying to crowdsource, if you will, a way of professionalizing oneself that does not include rolling the dice on Google, selling your firstborn to the Department of Education, or having a, you know, mortgage your house so you can go to one of these conferences. And so now that I just set all that up, the actual question is, imagine you woke up in a brand new world, identical to Earth, but you knew no one. You still have all the experience, skill, and knowledge you currently have, your food and shelter taken care of, but all you have is a laptop and no money. That's right, you are college freshman broke, Rev. You got somewhere to lay your head, a meal plan, computer Wi-Fi, and that's it. How would you build relationships with industry thought leaders over the next 30 days by working for free?
Well, I would love to do a podcast because I think that's a really great way to connect with people and to provide some thought leadership. But 30 days is really short. I don't know that I would get the return. It would probably be a combination of podcast, blog, and then a few, assuming this new world has social channels. Like, how can I get my thoughts out there in a way that people can discover it when I'm not talking to them? And that if somebody hears about me, you know, when they go look me up in this other world internet, what is the footprint I've left? So I would ramp up some online content as quickly as possible.
There you go. And podcasting, if you guys don't know, the numbers on podcasting, they're steadily climbing. It's been a while. It's been around for a long while, but it's really catching fire. And me personally, I tend to like it, if you can't already tell. So Rev, thank you so much for your time. Please tell us about your social profiles. If you got anything coming out, any books, where can we get some more you?
God bless. So my handle is the same on all networks. It's Rev Ciancio, R-E-V-C-I-A-N-C-I-O. I'm up on all the big ones, but I'm probably most heavy on the Instagram. And I do share a lot of ridiculous food photos. So if you are into food, that's sort of what I'm sharing. But it's usually connected back to me trying to help local businesses with their brand knowledge. With their brand data and their brand knowledge cards. I mean, that's what I'm doing. I am. I will be speaking at all the LSA boot camps this year. So if you are into, you know, local search and local business, and you want to learn more about how to maximize your brand data, go, you know, Google LSA boot camp and come to one of the boot camps. Come say hi and come ask me about how to correct your knowledge data.
LSA Bootcamp, folks, you want that. He works at Yext. The man knows what he is talking about. And I can personally attest that his Instagram hashtag food porn, friends. It's the pictures are, oh, God. So, Rev, thanks again. I do appreciate it.
Great, Tim. It was good to talk to you. Hopefully, we'll see you in Atlanta soon.
If you've enjoyed this episode of the Marketing Disenchanted podcast, consider becoming a patron at patreon.com/marketingdisenchanted. Your support helps with hosting the audio files, upgrading audio equipment, and so much more. And between you and me, my pledge levels are killing them. If you go look at other people's pledges and come back and look at mine, I'm a professional marketer, so you know I like my swag. I got t-shirts, USB thumb drives, not to mention my awesome products. So go to patreon.com/marketingdisenchanted. Your support is greatly appreciated. Thank you for doing me the high honor of listening to the very end. Please subscribe in iTunes, Stitcher, or your favorite podcasting app. Leave a 5-star rating and write a review telling people about my unmitigated awesomeness. Really helps out with getting the show shown. Follow me on Twitter at Tembo8482. That's T-E-M-B as in boy, O-8482. Or connect on LinkedIn, and I'll have my LinkedIn description in the show notes. And I'll see you next week.